Fahrenheit 451, Part 1, specifically, the destructive power of technology. Let's get started. We'll talk about three elements, primarily fire, materialism, and animals. Now, fire. Bradbury is using the idea of fire, the imagery of fire, in order to warn the reader of technology's destructive power, because while fire, or the control of fire, was early humans' first innovation, it was also a source of warmth that could be turned into a source of destruction. Take, for instance, the imagery of fire throughout the narrative, right? At every turn, the implication is technology, like fire, can simply just go out of control. The flame gun, for instance, which enables Montag to kill the woman and burn the books, essentially is the way in which fire, or the way in which technology, can be turned against people, can turned against the very way of life that people have, and essentially lessens the consequences of a crime. From firefighter to firemen in the narrative, Bradbury is considering how society can shift in its approach to technology, meaning instead of fighting fire or fighting the spread, the unchecked spread of technology, this society welcomes the spread of technology and in fact uses technology to turn on its people. Now, materialism. The idea here of materialism is that technology can control us because we let it, or rather because we want it to. He's exploring the idea of materialism, warning of technology's control over society. So the idea here is like the TV walls that give Mildred in the narrative a sense of status and a trivial meaning to her life, that also keeps her hostage. This futuristic entertainment makes people like her into passive receivers rather than active participants in their lives, right? Replacing individuality with conformity. Mildred, think about it. Mildred has three walls and she wants a fourth, right? Mildred is society. And like society, like her, we're almost all surrounded by the four walls of entertainment, enclosed, entrapped, imprisoned, really, by technology. So this society that worships technology for entertainment purposes essentially will be entrapped by that technology, will be held hostage by that technology. And that is the real power of technology. Its control lies in consumer spending. The more that people spend on technologies that they don't really need, the more they begin to rely on it, the more we give technology control over our lives. Like the headphones, the seashell headphones that keep us from real contact in the narrative, they separate us from the world and they get in the way, right? Technology not as a bridge between people, but as a blockade between people. Animals. In the narrative, animals are interesting because they demonstrate how technology controls us through the fear of what they might become. Think about the hound in the narrative. It's the use of the dog that is both lovable and vicious, or harmless and destructive. And I think that's the key of using animals to represent technology, that it's animals, or rather technology, that is not one or another, right? Not vicious or lovable, not harmless or destructive. Rather, it is one and the other. Like the dog, or like fire, it is both. Meaning it can be both vicious and lovable. Technology both allows us to allows progress, but it also incites regress. That's the implication here. The fear, and it is this fear of technology, the fear of the hound, that Montag and people in society have to overcome in order to escape from a society that needs technology in order to subsist. Bradbury is demonstrating that it is not our fear of technology that controls us. It is the fear of technology's potential, right? Because like the hound, or like the fire, we never really know what it's going to do. So putting these three together, fire, materials, and animals, what are we really saying about the first part of Fahrenheit 451? Well, they're all primitive, all of these. They're all simple, seemingly benign, and that is what makes them destructive, right? Is that technology always seems like it's all good for everyone. And as it turns out, it isn't. The future of technology is always in its past, because every creation leads to an eventual destruction. Everything that we've used for the better has also been used for the worse. Technology is both good and bad. The things that we make us, that we make to serve us, eventually control us, because technology at its core is assistive. And because it assists, because it helps us, it therefore disables us, and we are dependent on it. All right, here's a follow-up assignment. We'll chat on Discord. See you on the Google Drive.